Welcome, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us for this Q&A with the film Microplastic Madness. My name is Joanne Parsont. I'm the Director of Education for the California Film Institute, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you and have you join us for this conversation with the directors, Debby Lee Cohen and Atsuko Quirk. So welcome to you guys. It's so great to have you here. So this film is actually part of, originally, it was part of what was going to be our live annual, 12th annual environmental youth forum that CFI Education produces every year. That usually brings about 3,000 kids to the theater for a variety of screenings and interactive exhibits and all sorts of cool stuff, which we didn't get to do. But we do get to do this, which is a small series of some of the films that we planned to feature at the Environmental Youth Forum in a sort of EYF at Home series. And we're so thrilled to be able to kick off that series with Microplastic Madness, which was gonna be one of our highlight programs at EYF. And I also wanna thank our amazing community partner, Children for Change, who helped us put this, you know, work with this series and created some really amazing curriculum materials that you can find on our website on the film page. Where you would have registered for this Q&A. They've made some really incredible curriculum plans, lesson plans, discussion questions, some activities, some really cool things that you can do maybe we'll go through some of them when we talk about the film, but there's some great resources in there that I encourage you to check out. And also just a huge thanks to the whole team at Children for Change for working with us and making this happen. So welcome Debby and Atsuko. Thank you so much again for joining us from New York, where it's a little bit later. So we appreciate you, you know, ending your day with us. So let me just, obviously, to all of you who are joining us, I'm going to obviously ask a few questions, but we would love for you to jump in with any questions that you have for Debby and Atsuko. So for that, just please use the Q&A tab that you can find, most of you probably at the bottom of your screen, possibly in another configuration if you're on a different device. But just use that Q&A tab and type in your question and I will be more than happy to ask it live. If you have comments or anything else you wanna, you know, say to Debby or Atsuko or about the film or comments about the issues in the film, please go ahead and put those in the chat box and we are recording this session, so your chats will be recorded and Debby and Atsuko can keep up with what is happening along there as well as we go. So let's just start off with how you guys came up with, you know, the idea for this film. How did that come to fruition?
Okay, David, you want to go?
I'll start. Okay. Well, actually, we received a grant from the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, in the days when it was under Obama's administration. And it was a grant for three schools focused on street litter, beach litter, but also with a media component as well as citizen science. And we were in three different schools and they were all fascinating. And the criteria for the schools we picked was interesting. Most of them either had a significant population of students living in public housing, shelters, they were Title I schools, and all of them were neighborhoods where there was a significant amount of litter, not far from the school or right by the school. So it was an amazing experience. And one school stood out. You know, it was just like, it was such an amazing experience the moment that we walked into that school. And we had actually done a short program there the year before. And Atsuko, you take it.
Right. So, before we go farther, that we are a nonprofit organization based in New York City. And we go into, you know, that kind of underserved schools to, run educational programs. So then PS15, that's, you know, we shot for the movie, was one of the three that we went in 4 years ago.
The organization is Cafeteria Culture, is
right,
that right?
Cafeteria Culture.
And what's unique about our organization is that we're small, we wear a lot of hats, but we're not an organization where we're looking to be in twice as many schools next year running our program physically. What we do is we're developing new curriculum all the time and we're trying to stay really at the moment. What are the issues at the moment to be right on the cutting edge? And a lot of our cues we take from our students and our teachers. So we're lucky that way and it's fascinating. And then our goal is to share everything for free, which is not actually a great business model, but it's a good nonprofit model and it's good for accelerating change.
Right, so then we started our program at PS15 and the students sort of like their own storytelling about this plastic pollution issue was very, very inspiring to us. It was pretty different from what we expected. And then they really jumped on it and took it. And then they are the ones actually took our hands to go with their journey. So that was sort of like the inspiration that I, you know, felt like this needs to be shared. This, you know, needs to be really widely shared to, you know, let other people inspire to, you know, actually take action on this big issue. So then I told Debbie Lee, we have to make a movie.
Atsuko said, we have to make a feature documentary. Right, feature. I thought, well, it's one thing to make a movie, it's another thing to make a feature. And I really wasn't sure whether that would, whether we would sacrifice the organization by making the movie. I could see what that the movie was important, of course. And so much of the work we do anyway is about giving voice to youth, in particular underserved youth, because that's a voice in New York, not just New York City, but often around the world that's missing in the environmental movement.
Right, so then I also, I'm a filmmaker on my own, and then DVD also, you know, we have a production background and we know the production kind of, you know, so that everything sort of, you know, matched together to go into the direction. And I had a camera every single day in the school and, you know, basically shot everything that we did. So we have like a tremendous amount of footage. And yeah, so we sort of took it from there.
So one of the things I love about the film, of course, is the critical role that the students play in telling their own stories, sharing their own experiences. So how did you develop that sense of collaboration with them? And also, how did you get buy-in from the school?
Well, the biggest thing is the administration support, I think. The principal, who is actually in the movie, Miss Madison, she has the tremendous support to not only to us but to the community. She was not only the principal for the school, she was sort of like a leader of the whole community and sense of the strong tie in the community was really the big inspiration for us. And then for students, because we have a robust YouTube channel that has one of the videos that we have has 27 million views.
What?
And then, right, yeah, school lunch in Japan. And as soon as we're going to the classroom and, oh, YouTube channel has 27 million views. And then students
well, you
are,
could tell it this
really?
Way. Right, because like, if you walk in and the teacher says, oh, here's an organization, and they're going to, usually the teacher will say something like, oh, cafeteria culture is to talk about recycling. And I'm always like, we're not going to talk about recycling, you know? And then that's our next line. And suddenly they all wake up and they all sit on the edge of their chairs. And I say, yeah, Atsuko, she's a YouTube star. And then they're all, so media actually is a very, very important component. But there's other issues to that, which is many underserved schools, it's impossible to get enough media release forms from the parents. We have other schools that are phenomenal, but we struggle. We could spend 2-3 years getting the media release forms. This school, it's a part of their culture. Mm-hmm. And almost, you know, in this class, we had everybody's media release form. So that was another reason, very practical reason. And on a bigger scale, New York City, it's not so easy just to walk into a school. I'm sure this is true in Marin County, also in public schools, just to go in and say, oh, we're gonna spend a year making a feature documentary. But we put in our 10,000 hours and we paid our dues with the media office in New York City Department of Ed for years, you know, for years. And it was an enormous amount of work and it paid off for us finally by this opportunity of to have the trust to be in the classroom with the camera. And then the students actually became a part of the process very, very quickly, almost immediately.
And did you know that that was how you wanted it to evolve, as far as having them really being front and center and kind of being the ones narrating and telling the story?
Yes.
Right, right, definitely.
And we have made other short videos. We've made a lot of other videos for YouTube, and we had tried different things. So we had some idea of really the stylistically how we thought the movie should be. telling the story is always another issue, and that's a long, long process after, you know, after you're, we were out of the classroom, really shaping the story, as anybody who makes documentaries knows.
What would you say were the biggest challenges and benefits to working with a large group of 11-year-olds?
Go ahead, Debbie.
I missed it, Mike.
Oh, sorry, you're in it. So I said, what were the biggest challenges and benefits to working with a large group of 11-year-olds?
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, challenges, right? It was a tough class, I have to say. It is called ICT class. It means there are 40% of the students are either special ed students or some kind of learning issues. So the managing the class was tough to begin with. And then we had two classes so that, you know, we do one thing in one class, another thing in another class, and managing those. And then one class, 28 students in one class is a large size. So it was tough for scheduling and, class managing, but we did it, and then also for myself, that I have to be really filming everything, but also managing the class, teaching the class, prepping the class, talking to
a lot of work.
Yeah, a lot of work. So that was tough, but you know we.
But they're also, you know, it's just so satisfying. And that's part of the reason why we do what we love to do. We get so much in return from the students as well as the teachers. And in this case, at PS15, from the whole school community, that we feel enriched ourselves and educated. And to be let into the community for this opportunity was amazing. And to spend that kind of time. And also, as an environmental organization, to have two consecutive years to teach a class. And one of the things that's the movie that's like a sub narrative, it's like, of course, the narrative is about plastic pollution, it's about the community, but we didn't really think so much when we were making the movie that it was also very much about environmental education or climate education or plastic free education. And to the movie also speaks for the cause for more funding and funding for students. You know, if you go to a private school, students in private schools often will get quality environmental education or some kind of environmental education year after year. But in public school, that probably won't happen in New York City.
So there's a question in there.
I was going to, I'll read it out like this. from one of our lovely partners at Children for Change, says, one of the things I loved about the movie was the fact that you left in bits where the kids are just being kids. And it made the movie so real. How did you make those choices?
So this is more likely a filmmaker's, like a filmmaking decisions that we made, is that because this is their story, it's not our story, that they are the ones that who I told you that taking our hands to actually go to the journey. So I wanted to be not like us looking at them, right? When I film them, I always want it to be you and me shot so that I want to be close to them. I told every kid, looking at the lens, so that audience will feel like kids are actually talking directly to you. So then always the wide lens and physically close to them. Even in the classroom footage, we are not at the end, we're sort of waiting at the edge, but if somebody, you know, a child wants to say something, I run to them, right?
But and more than that, they know like some, after a while, it becomes sort of second nature to pause, like they have something great to say. And that's also kind of interesting. So to pause, to wait for the camera to be there, which is interesting too, because that gives them a moment where they don't feel like, you know, usually in a classroom, you feel the teacher calls one, you have to answer right away. So the pause becomes a natural part of it.
I mean, not every time, but
yes, the movie.
Right, yeah, sometimes.
Howard asked a really interesting question. I work for the countywide stormwater program in Marin, and we are working to reduce litter countywide. In the movie, they mentioned that they were able to reduce the litter in the neighborhood by 40%. What efforts or actions do you think were most successful in achieving this? Thank you, Howard, for asking that question, because we would have loved, you know, the whole movie could have been about that to some degree. That was just remarkable. And it wasn't just that school, the two other schools that were also funded through this EPA grant that we had. They all three schools did three litter surveys, like all on the same morning of the week, different seasons, but we tried to have some kind of continuity there. Of course, we would of course needed to do many, many more to have a big data set, but they all reduced by 40%, excluding cigarette butts. So cigarette butts are a real issue in New York City and they're small, and we left that out of the data. What I think personally, and then Atsuko, maybe you answer this question too, is that their connection, the students' connection to the neighborhood, it's like making change really from the ground up in the truest sense and in the most beautiful sense, where their artwork, you know, it's one thing for the city to put up a sign and say, don't litter or use the trash can or whatever. And a lot of the neighborhoods, there weren't even trash cans. It's another thing for it to be the voice of the student through their artwork or through the bag giveaways. They would go into their neighborhood bodega or their neighborhood deli. And so the people in the store know them. It's not like somebody from the outside coming in and saying, hey, we want to reduce the litter in your neighborhood. And then maybe the third part of that is the neighbors themselves, the community, seeing students in an act of actually doing something that surprised them. We'd hear over and over again these comments like, wow, I can't believe these kids, like, even if they didn't notice they were taking data, they'd say, I can't believe they're cleaning the litter up off the street, where usually it would be kind of a negative thing, like the kids are the ones who are making the litter, even though it's absolutely not true. It's a wider community problem. So I don't know if that answers the question. Atsuko, you have something to add to that?
Yeah, I think it's coming from the students, kids from their own neighborhood, really moved the adults to act, you know, so, oh, kids are doing it. Then, you know, you feel more responsible to react to that. So, and then just, yeah, going to the bodegas and, you know, I mean, in those communities, a lot of adults know the kids, or, you know, so the community tie is also strong. So that was a good part of it.
Are you seeing sort of longer term tangible changes in the local community with regard to that kind of awareness and response even now? Have you been tracking that?
Yes, I do. And because the, you know, we always use schools as a hub in the community to actually, you know, change the behavior and then, you know, advocacy work. And especially PS15, the culture that sort of like we brought in that those students started is still there and growing, and growing out to the community. Now families and cousins and uncles, aunts and grandmas and grandpas. So it's, at least you need 2 years to be in there. So that also made us really grow the value of those education in the school.
So it'd be interesting to see what would happen after 10 years. We have one school, a different school that has other challenges, but we've been there longer, maybe 6 or 7 years. And it's just interesting to begin to see as you become, as the sustainability part of the curriculum and the community becomes more embedded, the things that you struggle for the first couple of years, and you right. begin to think like, when does this become, this behavior is just something everyday for a majority of the population. And that's really why we should all be advocating for mandatory climate education, or, you know, like what a difference that would make. It's right. like the longer we wait, you can see it's like, why are we wasting our time?
Right. So another question from Annalisa, she says, we have some very engaged and responsive local officials here. Is there anything you learned as you engage students in advocacy, speaking of advocacy, that would help our local students engage with local officials?
Well, for one thing, I'd like to say that in the geography has changed in the last 2 years, thanks to Greta, which is really, really interesting. When we first started doing this in our program before, several years before the movie, and we would go to a city council member, even people we knew and we had nice relationships with, and we'd say, fifth graders would like to come and share some information, or we'd like to do a round table. They kind of like shrug their shoulders like, well, I know more about waste management than they do. But actually, we understood something that they didn't, which is that they can't be most elected officials or can't be experts in everything. And in particular, there's an opportunity to learn so much about on the ground activity, like what's happening. Kids will talk about it in a way that adults will never talk about it. And kids will also, if a child can explain combined sewer overflow, for instance, at a city council hearing, or they can give testimony with data, our elected officials have more bandwidth, I think, to listen to a young person explain it. It's just easier to understand than hearing an expert, one expert after another. If you've sat in those hearings where, you know, after hours, people are falling asleep, and then a fifth grader comes to speak, and they say it really clearly, and they're to the point, and people pay attention. So I actually think that the possibility of connecting civics to climate education, environmental education, is so critical, not only teaching our students, but also for the opportunity of what government can learn about the community. So in our case, about public housing, you know, information that I think, and garbage and litter in public housing, that our students have so much inside information that they shared that maybe otherwise, you know, maybe those nuances would not be known.
Also important part is the citizen science part, that bring the data to advocate for policy. So that's the, you know, movie has a lot of that elements in it, but that's sort of like an important part that students need to learn how to get the data, even this is small, but has the number, has the meanings. So that is really talking to elected officials.
And it's data in this case that the city doesn't have. So that's also remarkable. And so other schools start to see that and say, well, nobody's collecting that data in our neighborhood either. And it's not like Department of Sanitation in New York knows where all the litter hotspots are. And then there's something nuanced even about the litter itself and where those hotspots are, even within a 3-block radius, right? So that if you see a green plastic bag, one of the things that the students will be able to identify, oh, that bag comes from that bodega over there, but that bag comes from that bodega. So they can really identify the source, which then allows you to take the next step in terms of advocating for local change. By that outreach, they can target where the message needs to go.
That's so awesome. I love the way you weave together science, math, art, and civics all into one big package. That's one of the things that I found. Like, I just found myself, you know, drawn into this film more and more as it went along. And I was like, is this going to sustain itself as a feature length film? It just, you know, like I've seen, you know, I see a lot of stuff for youth and made by youth. And so, you know, I went in with my usual jaded approach, and it just completely charmed me from start to finish but I just loved the way that it wove all those different elements together. And it felt like that's also what made it so compelling for the students to be so engaged, and then they were so empowered. But on the art front, can you talk a little bit about the animation and how much of that was the students' work and sort of how you fit that in?
Well, it was a dream at the end of the school year. You know, it's so hard to get the time. You have these 40-minute slots where you bring kids in and you bring kids out. And then even if you have a designated classroom to get the animation set up, if anybody's done animation, by the time they're set up, it's time to go. And so we tried doing animation in the classroom, in the art room, in another classroom, and pulling kids out, especially towards the end of the year. And some really beautiful things came out of it. We didn't really use that animation exactly, but we used some of the storytelling and we used a lot of the artwork. And we decided also we had to take the quality up a notch. It was all shot on iPads, and it was incredible what the kids did, you know, as always, like they have the best ideas. So the animation was inspired by their work. And then I had worked professionally as an animator years ago, and I love doing meticulous raindrops. I mean, that was like vacation from fundraising. You know, I was like, oh, today's the day instead of writing a grant, I could say to Atsuko, I'm going to do raindrops today.
frame by frame. Yeah.
And with Daniel, our media assistant, he also learned a lot about animation while he was doing it, and he was excited to learn about it, and he did a lot of the digital work that was beautiful and recreating the graphics. And we were so lucky that we could do it all in-house. I mean, we could never have afforded to have somebody else do it. And it became also a great device for us in terms of storytelling when Atsuko and I would spend our hours, you know, trying to figure out what goes where and rearranging everything and then saying, oh my gosh, let's just put some animation there, you know, as a transition, or let's tell it with animation if we didn't have anybody else to tell it. So, you know, we're lucky that we've come to this with these other skills and that, you know, and basically, I mean, we built our animation stand, you know, with 2x4s, and we built several of them and moved them around depending where we were able to work. And so we were lucky.
Yeah, it's really fun. So I kind of feel like with every conversation I have, it comes up, of course, is, how is COVID-19 impacting the situation, as well as, you know, like, you know, I think we're all starting to be aware of, you know, that, oh, sure, there's been some positive changes around, you know, climate and stuff because of the lack of less pollution, but obviously there are other negative impacts. And I'm wondering what you're seeing, even just on both sides, on how the situation now is kind of affecting this plastic pollution problem, you know, and the situation in the New York City communities that you guys are working with.
I think we should first say something about PS15 and the community, because I think it's very, very hard to understand how difficult it is for communities right now. We knew there were issues. Just, I don't know if you've read in the news about New York City, for years we should have given every student an iPad, right? So finally every student, well, we think almost every student got an iPad. And then we think almost every student had access to internet, but still, there were many students who couldn't get onto the internet for various technical reasons. It wasn't just like you turned it on, it was easy, you know, and especially then there was a problem with Zoom and the security, it was unbelievable. So through that process of just organizing some great volunteers, 10 volunteers, some who had been interns before, cafeteria culture who had volunteered, some were college students, we get to see the spreadsheet of the needs of the school. And all I can say is that, you know, you want to do everything you can do for a school. You realize, you know, people are hungry, people are dying. People, one teacher, not at this school, at another school, wrote us an email one day and said, I'm so sorry I didn't get back to you. It was a school where some of the students from the movie actually go to middle school. And she wrote, I've been busy organizing Zoom funerals all week. So that's the first part. Okay. You know, it's just heartbreaking. And then the other part about the plastic, Atsuko, do you want to say something? Do you want to?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Well, the industry, the plastic industry and the chemical industry, but really the plastic industry, has used COVID-19 as an opportunity to exploit their positioning totally. And it's so disheartening where the plastic-free advocates all across the country sort of took a step back and said, okay, we'll just be quiet for right now. We're involved with a lot of coalitions. You just see one email after another. What are we going to do? What should we say? And people saying, let's just wait. The plastic industry jumped in. And recently they they asked Congress for $1 billion to help them. And I think, you know, they're making billions of dollars every year. Why do they need our tax dollars? And of course, we know what's going on in Marin. The students told us earlier where, you know, they're trying, you know, to block all these communities from not bringing in plastic bags, which is ridiculous. I mean, we all have to be careful no matter what bag we're bringing in, and we should change the protocol. We should all be packing our own groceries. We should all be washing our own bags. But why would we want to touch a plastic bag where we know the virus will last for 3 days, at least it has in several studies already on plastic. It might be better on a different kind of reusable fabric. We don't really know. So that part, the whole thing around reusables and not being able to bring reusables, I think there are many coalitions, and we're a part of them, that are working very, very hard to change the narrative on that. But it's a lot of work. and it's hard to see where that will go. And some of them are in your county and certainly in California.
Well, and I'm sure it's frustrating too to feel like, you know, you're fighting a new battle that you thought you already fought, and it's now it's bigger because, you know, like you said, that you know, all the people that were sort of fighting against it, have, you know, suddenly this seems more important, and it is, but yet we're losing traction. You know, that's just, yeah, it's super.
And I think the narrative has to change where it's really, we can't talk about just, we're having other issues in New York City around composting, for instance. The mayor cut all composting, which was a growing initiative and it was a growing program. It was great. And he just cut it right out of the budget. And we know in New York, for instance, when recycling was cut in after 9/11, I think recycling rate was like 20%. In 20 years, it never got back up to 20%. You know, so we know, and now we know so much more about the climate crisis and how urgent this is. So I guess the talking about changing the narrative is really the urgency of these issues. They cannot be diminished.
So, well, just along those lines, so what's your plan for the film, particularly as an educational resource, and how are you using it to inspire other students and communities like you're doing today? What's your plan?
Well, we are now tail end of the festival run, and then the whole thing happened. But now we switch to, you know, virtual screenings like, you know, you guys had. And now virtual screenings are outperforming live screenings as the view count, so, and reach out really far now. Now, you know, a lot of California-based organizations and schools are, you know, showing the movie. So we wanna really, not only people see, because this is, you know, the goal is not making money out of the movie. Goal is to make a change, right? So then we want people to act on it, so that we want to do as many Q&As as possible, so that audience will have a deeper engagement, like today, hopefully, right? So not just watching done. So that's the intention, right?
And we have an impact campaign, you know, strategy. Right. Some of them have shifted, of course, with coronavirus, but and we've shifted with it. We've spent an enormous amount of time adapting our resources around the movies so that they could be for remote learning or distant learning, I think is what you call it in Marin. And it's so far so good. It's a lot of work, but we're excited by that challenge and that opportunity. And we almost doubled our movie reach within the last 6 weeks. So we were quick to be able to change. We're a small organization. We're nervous about fundraising in next year, and we're trying to position ourselves so that we can continue and thrive, but we're not, you know, like everybody. We have to reinvent it to some degree. The plastic-free lunch day in the movie, which was super exciting, one of the things that came out of the movie before coronavirus was that New York City Department of Ed, which has 1.1 million students and 1,800 schools, the school food directors agreed to do a citywide plastic-free lunch day. And we worked very hard on preparing for it. It was supposed to be May 15th last week. So we're very sad not to have that opportunity. And we thought about doing virtual ones, but we couldn't. It was too unfair. There are a lot of kids who are getting their food from schools, and we have no control of the packaging that day. But the school food directors are still interested in doing it next school year. And just like in the movie, where we're kind of using our own strategies that we used years ago to get styrofoam out of schools that worked, which is if we do a pilot, people see change, and people need to see change. They need to be able to visualize it. And then it's not so hard often to jump from like one school to 1,800. It seems like it should be. And yes, there's steps in between. It's not that easy. But then you get to 1,800, and now there's this Urban School Food Alliance that really developed in part because of plastics, because of the styrofoam trays that are plastic. Now there's an opportunity to grow this campaign beyond New York City to these 10 other giant school districts. And if that happens, then we know that we're shifting manufacturing trends. The numbers are big enough and the contracts are big enough just from school food alone that we ship school food trends nationally, we ship manufacturing trends nationally, and we have this amazing opportunity. So that's where we hope to go, and doing it with both school food directors and school boards, but at the same time with students, with fifth graders on the ground, really collecting the data, helping to make these initiatives go and making their voice heard and demanding or asking for this change.
So do you want to tell people how they can set up their own virtual screenings if they wanted to, as far as like with their school or any other community groups?
Right, so if you go to microplasticmadness.org, then there's a tab that has host a screening, and your group, your school, your church, you know, whatever the organization or group that you belong to, you know, can host a screening.
So you fill out a form, it's a Google form, and it just helps us to get back to you. All Title I schools are for free. At some point, it'll be free for everyone. We're just not quite ready to do that yet. But we also are planning a free screening for World Oceans Day week with the UN as part of that whole week from June 1st through June 8th. And our screening will be for families on June 6th at 3 o'clock. We don't have it listed on the website yet, but it will be there probably in the next few days after we confirm with others' schedules. Dr. Chelsea Rokeman just told us today she can be on the panel afterwards, which will be great. She's a wonderful communicator, and the work she's doing is still amazing. And then on the Thursday, June 4th, we have special screenings all day for schools to sign up for that day that will be free. And then we'll have a Q&A at the end of the day with students who are in the movie.
Awesome. So yeah, so Atsuko, if you want, if you're interested in the chat, she's put both the Microplastic Madness website to go to for that, and also a little bit above that, also their YouTube channel that we talked about earlier.
We also have some games. We have a few fun games. We're making more, but we've got four of them up, and one's like a 2048 digital game, Microplastic Multiplied. We have another one coming. We have a board game that you can download called the Life Cycle Plastics that was developed by interns and some of our staff and tested by our students, and a few other things and other resources also.
That's awesome.
And please don't hesitate to email us up on the website. There's a little envelope icon, or, you know, you can always reach us. It comes to me or to Atsuko. We'd like to hear from you if there's something you don't see or that you need or additional. There's some curriculum. We have a lot of curriculum that's not yet on the website. That's actually the citizen science part is all been used in professional development with teachers in New York City for the last year. We're very happy to share that in Marin.
Thank you. Well, I know on behalf of Children for Change, Annalisa had just put in the chat to thank you all. You know, thank you so much for this program and for the work you're doing. And they're looking forward to working with you in those kinds of efforts. And thank you both so much for sharing
the
audiences and for taking the time to talk to us. It's been
thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Take care, and we'll talk soon.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.